right. Good evening. Welcome to Bible Baptist Church. Let's all stand. Take your hymnals, number 40. Are you washed in this? Are you washed in the blood? Amen. It's number 40. If you're able to stand all together, number 40. Are you washed in the blood? First, second, and last. Ready? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. Amen. Aren't you glad you're saved tonight?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Preacher often says, I'd rather be here at church tonight than in the best jail in Arkansas. And he ought to know, because he's been in more jails than any of us in Arkansas preaching, okay, preaching. Brother Taylor, I get the heebie-jeebies when I go. I don't like it. Okay, I'll pray, I'll give, but I want to sin. Amen. I don't know if it's, you know, I don't know if it's my guilty conscience from days past or what it is, Brother Owens, but man, when they start locking those doors, I'm glad I'm free. Amen. 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 Well, it's good to see you back tonight. We're looking forward to a good time in the Lord. We had a great time this morning, and God blessed. And haven't got to talk to the preacher, but I've seen a couple of posts, so I think everything went well up there, and we're looking forward to a good time here tonight. Brother Bojack, will you come pray for us, and then we'll hear from the youth choir.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for everybody being faithful and coming back tonight. Lord, I pray that you would bless Brother Gillespie as he brings your message tonight. Lord, I pray that you would give him your power and give him your Holy Spirit, Lord, and just give him liberty as he brings your message. Lord, I pray that you would speak through him, Lord, and let us have an open heart to hear what he has to say from you, Lord. And I pray that you would just help us not to be a hindrance to anyone else. I pray that you would help us just to sing out for you in the choir. Lord, in your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
He gave me more than ever asked for, more than ever dreamed. He gave me more than I could imagine when I came back home to him. When I asked him to forgive me, he gave me a robe and ring. I said, make me as one of your servants.
grew up in Sunday school, I memorized the golden rule, how Jesus came to set the sinner free. I know the story inside out, I can tell you all about the path that led him up to Calvary. But you ask me why he loves me, and I don't know what to say. But I'll never be the same, because he's changed my life when he became
everything to me. He's more than a story, more than words on a page of history. He's the air that I breathe, the water I thirst for, and the ground beneath my feet. He's everything, everything to me.
We're living in uncertain times, and more I find that I'm aware of just how fragile life can be. I want to tell the world I've found a love that turned my life around. They need to know that they can taste and see. Now every day I'm praying just to give my heart away. I want to live for Jesus so that someone else might see that he is
everything to me. He's more than a story, more than words on a page of history. He's the air that I breathe, the water.
Looking back over my life, at the end, I'll go to meet you, saying you've been
everything to me. You're more than a story, more than words on a page of history. You're the air that I breathe, the water.
Aren't you thankful Jesus is everything to us? Amen. I hope he's everything to you tonight. If you got your hymnals, number 488, A New Name in Glory, you can remain seated for this one. So number 488, A New Name in Glory. Amen. Ready? I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a Savior has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven. Sorry, guys. Never more to roam. All right, we're going to sing on the last verse. Hey, I want to sing out like we're saved, amen. I think about that when I was 11 years old, I remember I accepted Christ as my Savior, and thank God I did. And you have a time in your life when you accepted Christ as your Savior. I'm just saying, let's sing like we're saved. Okay, you're singing like you're not saved right now. I want you to sing out, amen. You don't have to be in the choir to sing out. You can sing out there in the pew, okay? I'm just saying. Now, help me out, okay? You can tell I can't hit all the notes. I need all the help I can get, amen. Okay, now on the last verse here, verse number 3, ready? In the book was written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a Savior has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
Amen. I'm like Brother Dalton. I'm glad I'm saved tonight.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. I know what I deserve.
Amen.
We're coming up on the anniversary of my salvation, amen. August 18th, 1972. I was a lost preacher's kid. On my way to hell, and why God hadn't already thumped me off into hell, I don't know. Brother Taylor, I'd been living a lie, and I knew it. We having a tent revival, had an evangelist in, had a tent set up outside, and preacher preaching. On Monday night, I went forward and rededicated my life. I'm the preacher's son, got to, you know, make sure I got my dad off my back for the rest of the week. Dad was off my back, but the Holy Spirit
Amen.
Was not. And on Friday night, he preached in Revelation 20. Books were open. Another book was open, which is the book of life. And whosoever is not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
Amen.
Wow. I wasn't in the book of life. My name was not written. And I realized just because my mom and my dad was saved, I couldn't go to heaven on their coattails. I went forward that Friday night. The evangelist said, Bobby, what'd you come for? I said, Brother Collins, I'm not saved. He said, go over and talk to your dad.
Amen.
Amen. And I got it settled. I'm coming up on, if my math is right, and y'all got some, y'all help me, okay? August 18th, 1972. Okay, I think I'm fixing to hit 49 years.
Amen.
Amen. 49 years.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I hope you're saved too. Let's have the ushers come forward at this time. I should have had y'all coming while I was up here. This singing gets me fired up. Y'all know what I usually do. Usually, Brother Taylor, I'm sitting right down over there. All I'm doing is amening and shouting and listening and crying and praying and all that. Now I got to do all the commercials and all that stuff. If you need an offering envelope, you'll raise your hand. These guys will get one to you. I'm kind of a little bit out of my comfort zone, okay? Brother Josh knows what I'm talking about. He doesn't usually lead the youth choir. I counted this morning, there was 9 members of the choir that are in Washington, and probably 8 or 9 of those are in the youth choir, too. Because usually it's full up here. So I thank the Lord. Everybody's doing a great job. And, you know, preacher always says sometimes when the cat's away, the mice will play, but we got a good crowd back here tonight, and I appreciate your faithfulness. I've been encouraged by the messages today. I want to be a Psalm 1 Christian.
Amen.
I do. God's been so good to me. I don't want to just shrivel up, be an old tumbleweed Christian and just blowing around all dried up. I don't want to be that way.
Amen.
And we have to remember and we have to repent. And we got to get back to our first love. Those were 2 powerful messages today, and I'm looking forward to the one tonight. So I'm glad you're here tonight. I didn't get to teach my Sunday school class this morning, so I'm a little kind of feel it in my bones a little bit. Amen. So, Brother Dalton was out preaching this morning, and we're glad he's back tonight, and he led the singing for Brother Lee tonight. Brother Dalton, come lead us in prayer. Say a word about soul winning on Saturday.
So we have soul winning at 9:30 on Saturday. We may be moving that to 10 o'clock soon, so I'll let you know. We may move back a little bit on the time, but we'll let y'all know for this Saturday. If you're able to come out, 9:30. I was out of town yesterday, so Brother Bojack filled in. And we didn't have anybody come yesterday, but it's been busy. People are out of town. But if you're able to come on Saturday, we encourage you. Come out. Last Saturday we had a young man get saved. He's like 22-year-old man. He got saved and born again, praise God. So you know what? It's not just confined to Saturday. It's every day of the week. You know, that's why Billy J always encourages us to get tracks, because it doesn't matter if it's Saturday. It doesn't matter if it's Monday through Friday. Every day of the week, we can be a witness for Christ, and that's what we want to be in El Dorado. We've been that for, 29 years, going on 30, and we're going to continue to be that, and we can all be that, okay? So let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for Brother Taylor coming in and preaching the word to us this morning. I know I wasn't here, but I heard great reports. And God, I pray that you'll give him your power tonight as he brings the message. And God, we help us to have a heart and ears ready to hear and just to take the word of God and to not reject it, Lord, but to accept it and to say, you know what, this is something I need to work on. Lord, speak to our hearts tonight. Help us to have that ground, that soil that we need to have in our hearts, and help us to take it and receive it. And Lord, I pray that you'll be with the remainder of the service, be with Brother JD and his family as they're out of town. Give them safe traveling mercies later this week as they fly back. And Lord, I pray that you'll be with all the ones on the prayer list. Lord, help us and be with the offering tonight. We love you. In Christ's name, we pray. Amen. Take your hymnals, number 542. 542. It's so sweet to trust in Jesus. Think about the words as we sing this, amen. Think about how you trust in Jesus, and very powerful hymn here. Right? So 542, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, right? 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. On the second. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust him as in blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him. Or on the last. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Amen. All right, we have a special at this time, and then Brother Taylor's going to come and preach for us.
I have been helpless, I have been helpless. Amen. I've not always been faithful to him, but he's always been faithful to me. Amen. Let's go to James chapter 3 tonight. James chapter 3. And I probably wouldn't mention this anywhere else, but Amy Wido recorded that track for her. So appreciate her and Brother Aaron. We go down and see them every year and love them. And I just love the whole Wido family. Amen. And so love the. We sure have enjoyed being here today. Sure appreciate you allowing us to come in and fill in. And we felt right at home today. You've been so kind and encouraging to our family. And so we just want to say thank you. I'm glad to know that as we take off back to Rogers tonight, we're going to leave behind some new friends down here in El Dorado. So I want you to know that we up, Brother Swinner and our church and our pastor, I want you to know that we love you and we pray for you and we cheer for you. And I just want to see the Lord work in the churches here right in Arkansas. And we're privileged to go all over the place, but I certainly have a burden for our churches and want to see just good, strong, healthy churches in our state. Our state needs it. And so this is thank you for your testimony and your kindness to us today. And we really dealt this morning really with our relationship with the Word of God in Sunday school. And this morning in the 11 o'clock hour, we dealt with our relationship with Jesus. So really the devotional aspects of our relationship with Jesus. So tonight I want to kind of turn the corner, preach a little bit different of a message to give some writing. But I trust that you've been helped today and encouraged, received a little bit of a shot in the arm as we kind of had just really a declared revival Sunday. And so hope that he'll do that one more time again tonight. Thank you, choir, for singing. That was a home run. And if you are faithful to the choir, let me encourage you, keep on being faithful. And that's a blessing to us out there. That makes a big difference in this church and the folks that come on Sunday nights to hear that. And so keep on going forward and keep on singing for Jesus. James chapter 3 will be our text tonight. And if I had to put a subtitle on the book of James, I would say it this way: exhibiting spiritual maturity during turbulent times. Exhibiting spiritual maturity during turbulent times. And how many would agree that our world over these past several years has gone through some turbulent times? And if there's ever a time for God's people to exhibit spiritual maturity, it is in these days that we're living in. And that's what the book of James is all about. It's really not a letter. The Apostle Paul wrote letters. This is a lecture. When the Apostle Paul would write letters, he'd always open up with grace and peace and how's your mama and how's your daddy. But James does none of that. There's no grace and there's no peace. It is a lecture and very Jewish in nature. You understand that? He's writing to save Jewish people. And so really he goes through chapter by chapter and zeroes in on specific areas of our their lives and our lives that we really need to exhibit that maturity in. Last year, I went to the dentist. My wife made me, amen. And so I went to the dentist and just a routine checkup. And they came in and looked things over, and the lady cleaned my teeth. And finally, the dentist came in, and he says, "Well, sir, do you have any concerns?" And I said, "Actually, I do." I said, "There's an area on my tongue I've been kind of concerned about." And there was, and I had Googled that. Listen, if you ever have anything wrong with you, do not Google the symptoms. Amen. If you Google the symptoms, you might as well start planning your funeral. And so I was concerned about this. And that's a concern for anybody. But especially when you speak for a living, there was an extra measure of concern there for me. And so I told him about that. He says, "Well, would you like to do a cancer screen?" And I said, "Well, since we're here," I played it off cool on the outside. On the inside, I thought, "Yes, do everything you can." And so they went and got the cancer gun. They scanned my mouth and my tongue. Afterwards, he says, "Man, everything looks good to me. Nothing looks abnormal. Everything looks normal to me." So you can imagine the sense of relief that I felt after he gave me that good news about my tongue on that day. But tonight, James is going to spiritually examine your tongue. And I'm going to let you know up front, the news is not good. Tonight, I want to preach on this subject: your tongue needs Jesus. Your tongue needs Jesus. Father, thank you for the music we've heard tonight that stirred our heart and lifted our eyes to you. Lord, thank you for salvation. Thank you that we're saved. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for second chances and grace and mercy. And Lord, thank you for the opportunity to have really just a revival Sunday here and really get back into a right relationship with you as we head into the fall months here coming. Lord, would you meet with us again tonight? And Lord, these folks did not come here to hear from me tonight. They've come to hear from you, and I pray that's the voice that they would hear. Lord, would you convict us tonight? Lord, this is a heavy passage. Lord, the preaching's not heavy, but the truths that we see in James chapter 3 are heavy, and I pray tonight we would feel the weight of your word. Lord, convict us tonight and lead us to repent repentance and brokenness and confession, and that's what we need. Lord, revive us. Send personal revival here tonight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's get a running start in the first couple of verses, then we'll jump into our outline tonight. James chapter 3, verse number 1. He says, my brethren. Now remember, he's writing to saved people. These are a Jewish people that had gotten saved, and because they had come to Jesus, and now they were being persecuted, and so they were going through a hard time, a difficult time, a discouraging time. And so he says, my brethren, be not many masters. That word masters means teachers, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Apparently, there were some young, overly zealous, eager believers in that spiritual community or those churches in that day that were a little overly zealous to become preachers and teachers. And he's not discouraging that, but you understand in that culture in that day, to maybe be a rabbi or something like that, there's a lot of notoriety that went along with that. So you can see how maybe a young believer would aspire to be that with the wrong motive. He's not discouraging them from being preachers and teachers. He's discouraging the wrong motive. Listen, it's a wonderful privilege to be a preacher, a teacher, or a spiritual leader in a church. But with that great privilege comes an even greater responsibility, and one day an even greater accountability. So he says, you better get your motive right. And so he goes on to say in verse number 2, and obviously preachers and teachers use communication, obviously. And so that opens up the door of the context of speech and the mouth and the tongue for the rest of the chapter. Verse number 2 says, for in many things we offend all. That is a synonymous phrase with Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. He's saying we all sin, we all fall, we all stumble, we all blow it. Can I get a witness right there? We all blow it from time to time. And he goes on to say, if any man offend not in word, if any man does not sin with his tongue, with his mouth, with his speech, the same is a perfect man. That word perfect in the New Testament would mean whole. It means to be complete. You and I would understand it to mean spiritually mature. So here's what he's saying. He's saying one of the marks of a spiritually mature believer is the ability to control their tongues. In other words, spiritually mature believers control their tongues. Spiritually immature believers do not control their tongues. Let me just ask you a question tonight on a Sunday night. Which one of those two categories do you fall into? Can I be transparent tonight? Far too often I find myself falling into a category I don't want to be in. He says one of the marks of a spiritually mature believer is the ability to control their tongues. Well, so often folks will walk into the back doors of our church, we act as if it's our job to size them up, and we kind of get our mental little checklist out, and we say, well, if they do this and this and this, they must be spiritual, and if they don't do this and don't do that, then they must not be spiritual. But James says, put your little checklist away. You want to know who's spiritual and who's not spiritual? Then just listen to their conversation. Because your words and your mouth and your tongue is going to tell on you. Dr. Tom Farrell just passed away 2 weeks ago, great evangelist. He said it this way. He said, every time you open your mouth, your heart is on parade. You want to know whether or not you're spiritual? Then just listen to the words coming out of your mouth. It goes on to say this, verse number 2 as well, and able also to bridle the whole body. In other words, if you can keep your tongue in check, you can keep the rest of your body and the rest of your life in check, because the tongue is the hardest part of your life to control. How many knows that to be true? That's why your tongue, and that's why my tongue, desperately needs Jesus. And starting in verse number 3, James is going to give us 3 points from this text about why your tongue and my tongue needs Jesus. First of all, tonight, notice this. Your tongue needs Jesus because it is powerful. Because it is powerful. In verse number 5, he's going to make a big point about the tongue. But before he gets there, he's going to set it up in verses 3 and 4 with 2 illustrations. Now, that's kind of backwards. Normally in preaching today, we'll make a point and then we'll illustrate it to give clarity and understanding. But James does it different. He's going to give 2 illustrations and then drive home the point. And the 2 illustrations, or the 2 objects that he's going to show us tonight, are 2 objects that are very small and yet possess power that was greatly disproportionate to their size. In other words, these are 2 objects that are very small yet very powerful. Notice the first one in verse number 3. He says, behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Isn't that amazing? You can take a 2-inch piece of metal, put it in that horse's mouth, strap some reins onto it, and put an 85-pound kid on the back of that 1,500-pound horse, and if that kid knows what he's doing, that kid can control that 1,500-pound animal because of the bit in its mouth. That bit is small, but boy, it's powerful. Notice verse number 4. He goes from land to sea. He goes from the nautical world, or the equine world, to the nautical world. He says in verse number 4, behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds and are turned about with a very small helm or rudder, whithersoever the governor, the captain listeth or desires. Here's a ship in a storm-tossed sea. The waves are crashing and the wind is blowing. Yet because of that little rudder attached to the back of that ship, the captain can navigate that ship wherever he desires it to go. That rudder, in comparison to the size of the ship, is very small, yet it is very powerful. Now, verse number 5, he's going to drive home the point. He set it up. He set up the point. Now he's going to drive home the point in verse 5. He says, even so the tongue is a little member, and yet boasteth great things. He says, just as the bit is small yet powerful, and just as the rudder is small yet powerful, even so your tongue is a small part of your body, yet it is very, very powerful. Well, listen to me. Never underestimate the amount of power your tongue can have on somebody else's life and even your own. These tongues are small, but boy, they're powerful. Daddy took his little girl out to breakfast one morning. They went to have pancakes. They ordered. Finally, the pancakes got to the table. And before they began to eat, the daddy looked across the table and said, honey, I want you to know the reason I brought you here today is that me and your mama's real proud of you. Well, you've been listening real good. You've had a good spirit and a good attitude. And we know God's going to use you and do great things in your life. And we want you to know that we love you. Boy, he picked his fork up, went to eat, and all of a sudden a little hand reached across the table, and a voice followed that little hand, and it said, longer, Daddy, longer. Well, he put the fork down. He said, well, honey, I want you to know me and your mama's proud of you, and we love you, and God's going to do great things with you, and we just thank the world of you. Well, he went back to eat again. All of a sudden, that little hand came across the table again. Longer, Daddy, longer. And that morning, that daddy did not get much to eat, but that little girl sure got what she needed that morning. Well, let me tell you something. We can do some good things with these tongues of ours, can't we? Well, we can speak life into people and comfort into people, healing into people, encouragement into people. In fact, the Bible says that a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold and pitchers of silver. You say, what does that mean? I don't know, but it speaks of the good power of the tongue. Amen? The Bible says that life and death are in the power of the tongue. Boy, these tongues can do some good things. In fact, there's precedents all throughout the Bible for that. But excuse me tonight, I do not believe. You can find verses on Proverbs for that, Old Testament, New Testament alike, the good that our tongue can do. But I do not believe that is the spirit or the context of James chapter 3. I don't believe he's dealing with the good power of the tongue. I believe he's talking about the bad power of the tongue. You say, why do you believe that? Notice the last illustration he gives in verse number 5, the second half of that verse. It says, behold, how great a matter. In the Greek there, that literally means forest fire. Behold, a matter, a forest fire, a little fire kindleth. Listen to me. All it takes is just one little spark, one little match, and all of a sudden, the entire forest is up in flames. How many remembers just several years ago the great Smoky Mountain forest fires? Remember that on television near Dollywood and all that? It was said that 17,900 acres were burned, 2,460 buildings were destroyed, 14 people lost their lives, over $2 billion of damage occurred because of that fire. And they believe it all went back to two teenage boys walking down a trail one day, lighting matches thrown on the ground, and all of a sudden one little match caused incredible destruction and devastation and damage. And listen to me, Jesus is saying your tongue can do the same exact thing. Listen to me, all it takes is one text message, one little Facebook post, one little conversation, one little lie, one piece of gossip, one bit of criticism. Come on now. Boy, these tongues are powerful. I'll never forget, I was in the eighth grade. Our Sunday school teacher was Glenn Richardson. Glenn Richardson probably didn't know a whole lot about the Bible, but he loved Jesus and he loved us, and that was enough at the time. But I remember Billy Glenn, he made a statement. I was in the eighth grade. I still remember, I'm 33 today. He said, "Sticks and stones may break my bones and words will never hurt me." It's one of the biggest lies that has ever been told. Listen, there's folks here tonight, words were spoken to you 20, 30 years ago, whether they were unintentional words, whether they were intentionally hurtful words from a parent, from a sibling, from a teacher, from a coach. Somebody said some words to you that hurt you, and 2-3 decades later, you still feel the sting and the pain of those words. And isn't it amazing that words can come out of our mouths in a matter of second and go on to live and cause hurt and pain in someone's mind and heart for the rest of their lives? Boy, these tongues are powerful. I'll never forget, I got into just a verbal fight with my dad as a teenager, and he burst out the front doors, and me and my mom sat there just in a silence for a few moments, and finally she looked over and said, "You know, your dad has feelings too." And I remember as the weight of that began to sink upon me as just a teenager. Can I say to the young people that are here tonight, your mom and daddy have feelings too. And the cutting words and the sarcastic words and the disrespectful words hurt the heart of your mom and daddy. And can I say to the mamas and daddies and grandparents in here, the words that we speak to our young people, they're going to remember those for the rest of their lives. Boy, our tongues need Jesus. Number one, because they're powerful. Number two, notice this. James says, not only is your tongue powerful, but number two, your tongue is dangerous. Your tongue is dangerous. It's powerful in the fact that it's, don't underestimate just because it's little, don't underestimate the damage it could do, but notice as well, it is dangerous. It says in verse number 6, and the tongue is. Now in verses 3, 4, and 5, he uses comparative language. He said the tongue is like a bit, the tongue is like a rudder, the tongue is like a little spark. But in verse number 6, he drops that comparative language, and no longer is he comparing the tongue to something else. Now he's going to tell us what the tongue is. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity, so is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body, and so on fire the course of nature, and is set on fire of hell. Without getting into the nitty-gritty phrase-by-phrase interpretation there, here's the overall meaning of verse number 6. He's saying your tongue has the ability to set every area of your life up in flames tonight. Listen, your tongue can set your marriage on fire. It can set a friendship on fire. It can set your testimony on fire. It can set your family on fire. It can set a church on fire. My wife was born and was raised up in Batesville, Arkansas, over there in White Drive Baptist Church. And years ago, they had a fire in their building. You may remember that, Brother Bob. And it started overnight, and they put it out, and they went on to remodel or rebuild that portion of the building. And if you were to go up there today and you didn't have that prior background knowledge, you would never know that. Listen, there's been many churches that have gone through fires, and they rebuilt and went on. But there's also many churches across this country that have gone through fires that were started by people's tongues and they never recovered. Now listen to me, I'm not talking about not speaking up when we ought to speak up. If there's sin, if there's wrong, if somebody needs to speak up, and for heaven's sake, somebody speak up. I'm talking about tonight, and James is talking tonight, about using our tongues to intentionally hurt people and destroy them and devastate their testimony. Come on now, using our tongues in intentionally hurtful ways. James says our tongues are like an uncontrolled fire. Notice he goes on to say in verse number 7, not only is our tongues uncontrolled fires, they're also an untamed beast. Your tongue's like an untamed beast. The Bible says, verse number 7, for every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. I was raised just south of Fort Worth in Cleburne, Texas. And one of the great aspects of living in Texas, and especially in that particular area of Texas, was that we were about 3.5-4 hours from SeaWorld. Amen. And so, man, every couple summers we go down there and see Shamu and see the dolphins do their tricks, and all these sea critters would come out and do their little performance. Boy, we can train some animals, can't we? Well, remember the days of circuses? I mean, elephants standing on their heads. I mean, chimpanzees riding motorcycles, bears having boxes. I mean, just crazy stuff. There's not a movie you don't, there's not a television show or movie you don't watch where some dog doesn't come running through the living room doing something. Come on now, we can train some animals. But the Bible says there's one beast we can't tame. Notice it goes on to say here in verse number 8, but the tongue can no man tame. Would you read that very carefully? The Bible says that no man can tame it. In other words, the tongue is humanly untamable, but I'm thankful that what you and I can't do, God can do. No man can tame it, but I'm here to tell you the Spirit of God can help you tame it. It's an untamed beast, but notice it goes on to say in verse number 8, it is an unruly evil. You say, what does unruly mean? It means like a toddler. Amen. Anybody have one of those? You say, what does that mean? It means it's restless. That's the true meaning of unruly. It means it's restless. Well, some of you got kids and grandkids. Well, you can't walk out of the room. You can't turn your back on them. You can't look away because the second you do, they're going to get in some kind of trouble. Come on now. I got one like that. I know. And the Bible says your tongue is the same way. Listen to me, you can't turn your back on it, you can't look away, you can't let your guard down, because the second you do, it's going to slash someone, it's going to cut someone, it's going to criticize someone, it's going to hurt someone. Your tongue is an unruly evil, the Bible says. You say, my soul, this is bad. It gets worse. Notice it goes on to say in verse 8, the last phrase there, full of deadly poison. You got poison at your house. Now, not just lying around on the counter, I hope. But locked up in the shed, you got chemicals for the yard. Underneath the bathroom cabinet, you have cleaning chemicals. I'm talking about on the back of the bottle, there's a skull and crossbones. It's poison. And there's a reason you got to keep it locked up so the grandkids and the dog and the cat, well, maybe that wouldn't be too bad, so that they don't get a hold of it. Listen, full of deadly poison. And listen to me, the Bible says, so is your tongue. And if you're not careful, you'll find yourself getting crosswaves with somebody around here, and you'll start cornering people and going all around the church, and you begin to infect people with verbal cyanide. I'm talking about you get sideways with somebody, and what do we do when we get sideways? Well, we start building our team, and we start recruiting people to our side. Come on, this is not my first rodeo. Come on. And all of a sudden, listen, you'll start going around, you'll say stuff like this. You ever notice this about him? You ever picked up on this about her? And all of a sudden, you start putting seed thoughts in people's minds and hearts that previously was not there with the intention to cause division and hurt and harm. Come on now. And God looks down at his church and his people and just grieves his heart. The tongue is a fire. In other words, your mouth is a flamethrower. And there's a whole lot of them here tonight. Boy, our tongues need Jesus. Because they're powerful, because they're dangerous, and lastly, number 3, our tongues need Jesus because they're inconsistent. They're inconsistent. Notice it goes on to say in verse number 9, therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth, out of the same mouth, out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Isn't it amazing? We can come to have a great Sunday here in church, and boy, we can sing the songs and greet one another, say amen at the right places, enjoy the choir, and man, just have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. And yet, after the last amen, we walk out to the cars, and before we even leave the church parking lot, we're already bickering and fussing and fighting and name calling. Come on now, out of the same exact mouth. In other words, out of one side of our mouth, we're blessing God, and the other side of our mouth, we're blasting men. You know why you have an inconsistent tongue? Because you have an inconsistent heart. Somebody said a forked tongue is connected to a forked heart. So you really don't have a tongue problem, you have a heart problem. Are you not like me? Do things not come out of your mouth every once in a while? And you think, why would I even say that? You say, well, I know how to whip this problem. I'm just going to zip my lips and never speak for the rest of my life. No, because long before it ever comes out of your mouth, it's birth in your heart. See, what's down in the well comes up in the bucket. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. We don't have a tongue problem. We have a heart problem. What if I said tonight, I got a little surprise for you folks. This whole past week, we have planted a recorder on your person. We put an audio recorder in your car and in your house and everywhere you've gone this week, we've been recording your conversations. And tonight I have it with me. And tonight I'm going to set it here on the platform and I'm going to press play. Boy, I wonder what we would hear you talk about. Well, I wonder who we would hear you talk about. Well, I'm glad nobody's been recording me. See, the good news is no one has recorded you. But the bad news is actually somebody has. Well, I got done preaching at a camp one time and a teenager came to me. He said, "Have you been spying on my life?" I said, "No, but God has." Listen, if nobody else heard it, he heard it. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of thy mouth. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. You say, Brother Taylor, I mean, that's a cute little sermon title you got there, and I'm sure that'll look good on the website tonight and on the Facebook page when they post it. That's a cute little title, Brother Taylor. No, listen to me. It's more than just a cute little sermon title. It's the point of the passage. Do you realize when you study James chapter 3, he goes through and he lists problem after problem after problem after problem with the tongue, but he never one time gives a solution. You say, why is that? Because when we get done with James chapter 3, he wants us to be left reeling and staggering at the overwhelming magnitude of the problem inside of our mouths so that you and I would know that the only hope that we have is Jesus Christ alone. And I want you to know that he can sanctify us. You may sit here and you say, well, if I'm never going to have perfect speech this side of heaven, then what's the point? That's a sorry attitude. Well, if we took that, if that was our idea, our thought of every other area in our lives, we'd be pretty sorry people, wouldn't we? But the power of the Holy Spirit can help us and sanctify us, and the Word of God cleanses us. Come on now, there ought to be spiritual growth. I may not have a perfect tongue this side of heaven, but boy, I ought to be maturing all the time in my speech as I walk and I grow in my relationship with Jesus. Your tongue needs Jesus. Can we bring it on home tonight and close with this? Can we just get real tonight? The fact of the matter is, some of your homes are toxic. Your marriage is toxic. The relationship some of these young people have with their parents, it's toxic. The fact of the matter is, some of your homes, there's not a good spirit in your home. There's no peace. There's no joy. There's always tension all the time. Everybody's walking on eggshells around each other. Toxic. And a lot of it has to go back to the way that you talk to one another. I love to cut up and I love to give people a hard time. I love some sarcasm. Come on now. I love all that. But you know as well as I do, there comes a time when you cross the line and no longer, it's not funny anymore. Now it's hurtful. And I'm telling you, there's some spouses in here, and there's some mamas and daddies, and there's some young people who tonight need to come down and say, Lord, I can't do it on my own. And Lord, truly, I don't have a tongue problem. Truly, I have a heart problem. God, would you change my heart, and would you change my tongue tonight? My tongue needs Jesus. Father, we love you tonight. And Lord, it is a heavy, heavy passage. And Lord, tonight, I believe we do feel the weight of this. And Lord, without your help, these tongues will hurt and cut and cause destruction in other people's lives. But Lord, that doesn't have to be the case if we come and cleave to you and cry out to you and ask you by the Holy Spirit's power to change our hearts and to sanctify us. Lord, we don't want to just live our lives as spiritually immature believers. Lord, we want to do as the book of James exhorts us. We want to grow. And so, Lord, if we feel any sting of conviction tonight, Lord, help us not to let that cause us to run from you. Lord, conviction ought to cause us to run to you and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I need your help. Without you, I can do nothing. If you're here tonight and say, Brother Taylor, I'm just going to keep it general. Just keep it general. How many would say tonight, Brother Taylor, God spoke to my heart tonight? If that's you, would you lift your hand up? I just want to pray for you. Yes, yes, yes. Father, you see the hands and the hearts here tonight. Lord, help us to respond and do business with you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet tonight as the music begins to play. And the altar's open, friend. Listen, if our tongue needs Jesus, there's only one person we can come to. Just get raw, just get real, just get open and honest with God and say, God, you know. You know. And Jesus, I believe that you have the power to change people's hearts and lives. And Lord, I'm asking you to change my heart and my life. Lord, the way we've been talking to one another, Lord, I think about our marriage and I think about our home and my relationship with my mom and my daddy and our kids. Lord, these tongues are out of control. Jesus, I need your help. If you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, can I say that same tongue that we've sinned against God with, that same tongue we can cry out to Him and ask Him to save us tonight? For the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. With that same tongue that you sinned against Him with, that same tongue you can cry out to Him and ask Him to save you, you can be saved tonight. If you're here without Jesus Christ, we want to invite you to step out of your seat, walk right down this aisle, let us take a Bible and show you how to be saved on a Sunday night. Would you do that? Altar's open, invitation's yours. Won't you come?
If you need to come, there's still time. Speaking to your heart.